In 1982, as a third division side, Oxford United was facing closure due to bank debts, but were rescued when businessman and newspaper proprietor Robert Maxwell completed a takeover. After a failed attempt to merge the club with Reading, Oxford regrouped to find themselves in football's top flight just 23 years after being elected into the Football League. Maxwell, indeed, was visionary.
I'm a person who'd rather have a horrible ending than horrors without end. And so, having saved it, and subject to getting the support that I've asked for from the Supporters Club and from the City and South Oxfordshire District Council, I'm fully satisfied that Oxford United will give value for money and will play entertaining football for many, many years to come, successfully.
Well, it didn't quite end up like that. It was Jim Smith that led his team to the top flight and then left just after winning promotion. It was a former Reading boss, Morris Evans, that took on the challenge. He steered them to Wembley, beating Smith's new club, Queen's Park Rangers, to win the League Cup, better known then, of course, as the Milk Cup. They avoided relegation on the last day, but it remains Oxford United's finest season before the club eventually slipped back to its non-league roots. It's one of the most intriguing stories of modern-day football, and to share the time of their lives are three players who featured in that Wembley victory. The Glaswegian-born Republic of Ireland star Ray Houghton signed from Fulham at the start of the season. A midfield live wire, he scored a goal in the Milk Cup final and on the last day victory over Arsenal that saved the club from the drop. Along with Ray, Kevin Brock and Trevor Hebbard, my next guest starred in the Oxford midfield. He went on to enjoy nine seasons at the club. Lambeth-born Les Phillips started his career at Birmingham, but signed for Jim Smith in 1984. He was part of the side that won both the old third and second division titles as the club reached the top flight. Apart from Smith, he was managed by Morris Evans, Mark Lawrenson and Brian Houghton during his time before moving on to Northampton in 1993. My next guest was signed from Newport County, fresh from leading the Welsh outfit to the quarter-final of the European Cup Winners' Cup. He became an instant hit in the yellow shirt. In just over three seasons, John Aldridge played 141 games and scored a staggering 90 goals. He starred with Les in all three divisions for Oxford and, like Ray, went on to greater heights with Liverpool and the Republic of Ireland. Ray, Oxford United in the top flight and winning a cup, it seems almost unimaginable to people now. How far above their weight were they punching?
I was really looking forward to it. I thought it was a step up for me. I have previously been at Fulham, so I was waiting for my opportunity to move up to the next level, and certainly Oxford gave me that chance.
Mm. Les, you've been part of those promotion-winning sides, but when you moved there, were you aware of one Robert Maxwell?
I'd heard of him, yeah. Not all good, but he did save the club and got the momentum going, so, yeah, I'd heard of him.
Was he involved at all, John, in the negotiations to bring you to the club?
Yeah, he was. Newport County had accepted 78,000, which was a strange figure, really, for myself, and I knew he was largely involved in that. I spoke to him personally before I spoke to Jim Smith as well.
What was he like?
Well, when he spoke, you sat back and listened. You know, a little bit of an intimidating presence with him, and he told me about the goals and his sights, where he wanted the team to go. And he made me under no illusions, you know, the top flight was attainable. So with that in mind, because at the time Sunderland were knocking on the door with myself as well, but Len Ashurst couldn't quite get the resources to get me. Robert Maxwell had the punch, and he swayed me to go, and it worked great. Jim Smith brought some fantastic players in, like Les, like Ray. Billy Hamilton was magnificent, and you had to, you know, take your hats off to Mr. Maxwell, what he'd done for the club.
Mm. On a day-to-day basis, Ray, did you see a lot of him around the club?
No, not at all. No, that wasn't his brief. Mm. You know, he stayed in his office. He had a massive council estate, it was. It was this massive big house which he paid a peppercorn rent for. And that's where we went, when you went to negotiate your contracts.
Pergamon Press, wasn't it?
Pergamon Press. Yeah, we used to go there if I had to go and speak to him about your contract. But it used to take 5 hours. I remember the first time I went to see him for a new contract. Morris Evans was the manager at the time, and Morris and I had gone to the office to meet him. sat me down, says, what do you want? I says, negotiate a new contract, Mr. Chairman. Right, Evans, you out. Because the chairman, he only ever knew one name. It was either your Christian name or your surname. He didn't know both. So he'd either call me Ray, or the next time he'd just call me Houghton, because he didn't know Ray Houghton went together. So he sat me down and he said, right, what do you want? So I started to give him a brief of what I think I was worth and the reasons why I'm in there. And then he said, it was about 2 minutes at last. He said, right, I'll be back in a minute. So he goes out the door, Morris comes walking back in. I said, Morris, everything all right? I said, I don't know. I said, all I said is I think I should be worth this. And he left. 45 minutes later, he comes back. Where were we? I said, at the start, you know, we've not even got going yet. Anyway, what do you want? I want this. Okay, I'll be back in a minute. This went on 5 times. He went in and out. And what I realised afterwards, he had all these different offices and he had different meetings going on in all these different places. And he was going around talking to not just me about football. He was over there talking about business to someone else and another room to someone else. And I think after 5 hours, we finally got an agreement that I could have this new contract.
Did he get what he wanted, though?
I can't even remember. I was like, in the end, I was just... I said to Morris at one stage, look, I'm going. I said, I can't be bothered. This is madness. Mm. I said, I don't even know where we are now. What have I agreed or not? I said, what's the length of time? Is that a year, 2 years? What's going on? And finally, we always say that his knowledge of football wasn't great. And we were sitting around this massive big table, and there was the chairman, Morris Evans, and myself. And the chairman said to Morris, Morris, who in the England team does Ray play like? And Morris's head's frazzled by then because he's had enough as well. You know, as the manager, he's had no say. He's had to wait around to me, with me, to find out exactly what the chairman's going to offer me. And then he couldn't think of anyone. And then the chairman, quick as you like, turned and says, I know who exactly plays like Ray. He says, who's that then? He says, Mark Wright, 6'3" centre-half who played for England. And that was his knowledge of football. There was me, a little winger, playing for the Republic of Ireland. So when it came to, you know, the money side of things, he was fine. He was all right, John, wasn't he? But
yeah.
I think overall, if you were going to talk football to him,
no,
there was no point. There was no point.
No, he came in one day and Malcolm Shotton was the captain. He said, Malcolm, if you're in the toss, go for an early goal. Meaning, we got the gist of it afterwards. I think he meant go down the slope. First half kicking to, you know, the our home supporters. But he didn't know nothing about football, really. I think he enjoyed watching it, of course, but no, it was really
sad. Did he come in the dressing room, was that?
Yeah, he'd come in the dressing room before most home games. Yeah. You know, and sometimes after the game, especially when we got promotion, he was always there, hugging the attention at the time, and quite rightly so, for what he'd done for the club.
Yeah. I mean, it was a club that was full of characters, wasn't it, Les? Because Jim Smith took you to the club for a start. Now, what was it like to play for Jim?
Well, roller coaster. He used to scare the shit out of me, basically. After game, if you think you've had a poor game, he used to go back and set change him. But the thing is, he would absolutely tear you to shreds. But if you're in an away game, he'd be your best mate on the coach, pouring bottles of wine, playing cards, spitting all over you. And he was just such a old-style manager, but I think he's like Alex Ferguson, that kind of thing. But a great manager, man manager. You know, I don't think he was tactics. I don't think really not sort of. He just said, picks his team that he wants, go out and play.
Because I mean, he's a football figure that I think everybody loves these days. But you know, did he rule by fear then, John?
Again, respect, the utmost respect. But I think Jim's philosophy on football was similar to that. If they score 3 goals, we'll score 4. Because he had two excellent wingers. And our fullbacks, Bobby McDonald and Dave Lang, were like wingers. And they were, you know, had licence to just get forward, get the last third and put deliveries into the box, which them two lads could do.
What's with David?
Brilliant.
He must have created 70% of your goals.
Oh, Lange was a fantastic cross of the ball.
First one to admit, can't defend, won't defend. But wingers just hate playing him because they're all tracking him back.
Yeah, we had people who would sit, John Truick or Les, who would sit when he ventured forward just to make sure the gap was filled in. And Lange was just up and down for 90 minutes. Superb, great player, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Excellent.
So what was the reaction at the club then when, you know, Jim's led you to 2 successive promotions? What was the reaction of the players when he went just as you're about to play in the top flight?
Well, I remember we was in Portugal and all of a sudden Jim was there and then he was gone. And we didn't really know what was going on until we found out that I think he just asked for a better contract. And I think, Max had said, you're having this. And Jim thought it was worth more than that, which he should have given him anything to keep him there, really.
I think Jim just stood his ground against Robert Maxwell. He thought, you know, you've got a fight on your hands here. and two probably couldn't see eye to eye, or one wouldn't give in. Next minute, QPR offered him, you know, the type of contract he wanted, and he went. And it was a massive shock to me, because I was looking forward so much. You know, Jim had done brilliant that season, getting us up, you know, easily, really, in that division. And I thought, like, you know, you need a manager like that behind you if you're going to go into the top level. So when he went, it was a huge shock, and couldn't believe it, really. I phoned him up, you know, he tried to find out why. Will you change your mind, Jim, and type of thing. And there's no way. He just wished us all the best. You know, you go your own way. But as a manager, brilliant. As a man as well, you couldn't help but like Jim. Yeah. Mm.
Do you think he'd have stayed if they'd offered him more money?
They should have given whatever he wanted, because what he'd achieved. And like I said, it was, by him going, was a sort of downer, wasn't it? Like I said, he's looking forward to next season with a great manager, a team that's really on the up, and suddenly part of that partnership was gone. And, you know, anything to keep him there, it should have been done, really.
But he was funny as well, you know, in the dressing room. Hilarious, absolutely. And that's what you need, a manager who can, you know, realise when you need to be lax at times. After training, you know, he'd come in, you'd have the banter with him. And after
what would he get up to then?
Oh, Jim, what wouldn't he get up to?
We go pre-season, and he said, all right, let's all have a drink. Everyone got absolutely hammered, basically. But he was doing, I ho through the... You're doing, was it the 3,000 metres we had to do? Knowing that we was going to be ill the next day because it was pre-season. He got us all drunk. Then we're on the beach, had us, didn't he?
Yeah, that was in Portugal, yeah. That's another story.
Well, tell us it then.
We were going to Portugal. It was... It was around about January time. The weather was really poor, you know, in England, and, you know, we couldn't play, precisely. So he took us to Portugal, arranged the game with Ferenc, and we went there for 4 days, but we misbehaved on the first night, as you do. In Gatwick Airport Hotel, and so he took us into the hotel. You know, we had a big lunch, and straight after the lunch, kit on the beach, runners everywhere for misbehaving. Everyone was being sick, throwing up here, there and everywhere. It was a nightmare, and then got us back, found us, told us that you learn a lesson. And he was right, you know, it was a hard lesson to learn, because it wasn't very nice, was it?
But it would be left at that then. There'd be no grudge, nothing.
Yeah, it wouldn't carry on.
No, that'd be it.
Well, after Jim's gone, of course, it's Maurice Evans who's took over. Who signed you, didn't he, Ray?
Yeah, he did, yeah. Maurice tried to sign me when he was at Reading, when I left West Ham back in 1982. He came in and asked if I would like to go to Reading, but Fulham was a better option. And the story was, I could have went to QPR, funnily enough, at the start of that season. Jim Smith actually came in to try and sign me, ironically enough, after, you know, him leaving Oxford. And Jim had agreed a figure with Fulham, but he said he was waiting for his chairman, Jim Gregory, to get back to him, and Jim was on holiday. So I was waiting around for about a week to find out what was happening. I hadn't heard anything. So I rung Jim up, what's the story? Still not back, Ray, I'll give you a ring in 3 days. 3 days later, he rang me to say, Jim Gregory said you're not worth 100 grand, so I can't buy you. So that was the end of that. So I was in limbo at that stage, because obviously Fulham needed the money, they wanted me to go. And then West Brom came in, Johnny Giles, and I went up to see Johnny up in Birmingham. I was in the hotel, and he said, look, I really want you to sign. I said, no, look, I'd like you to sleep on it. I said, you know, I'll just get it clear in my mind. It's a big decision moving up to Birmingham, and I want to make sure I'm right with it. And he said, I don't want to do this, and the reason why, Ray, this happened to me before. And the 11th hour, a club came in, and that player signed from the next morning. And I said, don't worry, you'll be fine, nothing will happen. That night, Maurice rang me and said, look, we'd like you to talk to you, we'd like you to bring you to Oxford. And I just felt it was a better option for me, because they'd just been promoted. They'd done you had a reasonable start, and you had some decent points at the start of the season. So I went to see Maurice, and he convinced me straight away. I think the boys will take it. Maurice was a football man. You know, he loved the game. He liked players to go out and express themselves. And we were fortunate. We mentioned Bobby McDonald, Dave Lang, and players that just wanted to go out there. They didn't want you to say, sit back and you can't do, restrict them in any way. You had to give them license to go and express themselves. And his nickname was Doopty Doo. I didn't really notice, but in training, he used to wander around, you know, on the side of the pitch. Ray Graydon would be taking training, you could hear Morris just going away going doop de doo doop de doop doop doop, and that was his nickname from then on. He was a special character. You sadly missed today.
Yeah.
But I think for all of us, and particularly me at that time in my footballing career, I need someone to believe in me and give me a chance, and that's what he did. He just said, look, yeah, listen, you can play, go out and express yourself. Mm.
So was he very different from Jim Smith?
Completely opposite. Mm. He was, with the phrase, maybe too nice of me.
Yeah.
Too laid back, too nice to be a manager. But like the way you said, he loved football, but he knew his football as well. Like I said, I think he's more tactical aware than what Jim was on that side, but like the way you said again, he just lets go out and play. Having two big centre-halves helped as well.
Yeah.
Kick the shit out,
well, we had probably the hardest team in all the divisions with Birmingham City at the time, didn't we?
Yeah.
You know, and I'm thinking how Morris is going to handle this, because, to be fair, if you sat with Morris, when he got the job, I thought, he was the chief scout at the time, I thought, no, I don't think he's going to be able to handle some of the teams, some of the lads in our team. And, you know, he was so quiet. Gentleman, he opened the door for you, and he's a lovely, lovely man. And I really doubted his ability, you know, to keep us on the level we were. He answered it brilliantly.
Some of the boys thought he was a soft touch?
Yeah, big time. But what he did, he knew nothing needed changing. Jim had put everything in place, just carry it forward, you know, get likes, you know, Ray in, and a couple of good players, and kept it going. He didn't change it. But it did change, you know. Within the dressing room, you know, without Jim there, the character. But he took it over, and I thought he'd done exceptionally well, really.
Was there any sort of hint, then, Les, of the sort of season you might be going to have? After all, you'd just come up two divisions.
Yeah, I think, you know, like a team of Oxford side, I think just staying up, you know, finishing fifth, sixth and bottom is an achievement, which it probably was that kind of position we ended up. But winning, obviously, the Milk Cup... Mm. I think we went past what we were going to achieve, obviously, but we were still a team on the up, so there was always that optimism. You know, we hadn't levelled out at any stage. We just wanted to play against the big boys, and I thought we'd done it quite well.
What was great about the team as well, we had a lot of journeyman players, really, didn't we? You know, we had Shotton and Briggsy, who'd been around the lower divisions for a long time, and it was great to give them their opportunity in the top flight. For them to play against the best sides, you know, was fantastic for them. And I think there was when you go to clubs, you're always looking for a spirit. You're always looking for people that get on well together, who like to be in each other's company, and you see that when they go out to play. And that's one thing that we had in abundance was a togetherness. Yeah, you know, we all show them sort of attitude, and I think that came out in our play as well. Yeah. We had highs, we had lows, we had some great games, we had some poor games. Mm-hmm. My first game, for example, was Liverpool at home. Remember, we drew 2-2. I think Alan Kennedy scored an OG that day.
Minute, yeah.
And the atmosphere at the ground, Liverpool coming to the Manor grounds, you know, you wouldn't believe it. You know, with the slope, and at that stage we had the fencing up and all that, and the noise that generated was fantastic. I don't know what the Liverpool players thought of running out of Oxford, to be honest, because, you know, they probably got there, they thought, what are we doing here? Because
the ground hadn't changed, had it, from the non-league games, basically, you know, titivated up here, there and everywhere. But, you know, you go in, it was a typical lower league ground, and Liverpool, Arsenal, Chelsea, Everton, all these teams come and thinking, don't fancy this with the slope. And as Ray said, the atmosphere, it was fantastic at the time, wasn't it? The camaraderie amongst the lads was brilliant, you know. After the away games, the coach had pulled back into the Manor, and we had to go into the pub across the way, all the lads, and buy a round each before you got off. And that was
not everyone bought a round, well, John, didn't
they? Briggsy used to get off when it was his round, Gary Briggs. But you know, we had, you know, whether we'd win, lose, or draw, you know, we'd all stick together, you know, amongst each other.
If we lost, we'd still... It'd make a point of all sticking together, wouldn't it? And the spirit is just unbelievable, really.
And midweek games as well. Bogart's got hit a few times. Let's be honest, lads, the club and town.
In fact, I got hit by John outside Bogart. He won't aim for me, though.
Who were you aiming for?
Shooting, really.
Long story, that one.
Yeah. Can you imagine, we're in a university place, aren't we, which is Oxford anyway, so there's a lot of kids and... They didn't like us, you know. We were the riffraff, really. You know, like, you know, the Oxford was all about, you know, these young, up and coming world leaders. You know, and there's this group of footballers who they'd look down their noses at all the time. So, whenever we went into the club, there was always an edge in there. You always felt that you weren't comfortable. They didn't really want you in there, which made us want to stay there even more, didn't it? You know what I mean?
We had some great nights there.
And I think on one or two occasions that the students thought they could pick on one or two.
But Bobby McDonald that night. Yeah,
tell him the story.
Someone picked on Bobby McDonald, didn't he?
Yeah, because Bobby McDonald said to us, he said, "Let's, John, we come outside, mate, because I'm taking this bloke outside to have a bit of a ding-dong." But he's got a couple of mates with him. So if they follow you out, will you follow? He said, "Yeah, no problem." I think we got outside and they're scrapping and two go. Then we've gone out. He throws a punch, decks me. Misses the bloke, ducks and smashes me straight in the
So it all went off, didn't it? Yeah. It all went off. Thankfully, no one was there, but it was calm.
But that was it. I mean, as we say, there was always an edge when you went in there. These students were always looking for, they can't drink properly, and we were an easy target for them. But they picked in Briggsy and Shorten one time, which was the worst thing they ever done, wasn't it? And the boys just let them know that... there's only one group in town, and it was us. Yeah. It was a great laugh down there. We used to get, but we all, there used to be a big group of us that would go down there. It wasn't one or two. No. It was eight or nine that would go in there, after the games. And I think that's what the spirit we talked about. That was the attitude that we had at that particular time.
The draw being quite kind to you as well, hadn't it? I think, I know you'd had some decent sides to play, but you got them all at the Manor Ground, didn't you?
Yeah.
I always remember the atmosphere there, particularly at night.
It was fantastic. Yeah. Another thing about the Manor, if we won the toss, obviously we'd kick uphill, and you could see the away teams, when they got used to coming to the Manor, oh no, they're going to be bombing down the hill. They'd want to be 2-0 up at half time to have a chance of drawing.
Yeah.
With Lange bombing down there and, in scoring goals was fun.
But that's what happened one season. Ipswich were winning 3-0 at half time.
And it was 2-0. It was 2-0 at half time.
2-0.
And then they scored just after half time.
Yeah.
And you got hat-trick in 14 minutes?
It's something like that, yeah. And we won 4-3, didn't we?
4-3. And Neil Slatter scored the win.
That typifies what Les is trying to say. The teams were really intimidated by us kicking downhill the second. Now, in the team, what we had, no matter what we had, get the balls out wide, balls into the box. Big Billy Hamilton was some player, by the way.
Yeah.
What a fantastic player he was.
And we missed him that season, didn't we, really?
Because
he was out injured for a long spell. Jeremy
Charlo
came in and played up front. But on that run as well, I don't know what round it was, but... Do you remember Charlo says, "Should we not shave until the final?" And if you see the pictures again, Charlo's got a beard in it. But we've seen since after about 3 or 4 weeks and said, "Hang on a minute, I'm not having any more." So we all shaved it off. He was the only one that kept his beard going, didn't he? But I think, when people say, "Have you got a favourite? Do you wear same pair of underpants or anything like that?" I think we go into that way of not shaving because we wanted to get on a run and get through as far as we can. And because it was our first season in the top flight as well, I think we just went out and played with a freedom, didn't we?
We
weren't worried about anything.
Yeah, we
weren't worried about relegation at that stage.
We just wanted to stay up, keep our heads above water. But we had this cup run to go for. And as you quite rightly said, Jeff, it played into our hands. We got the draws, in Norwich and the teams at home and whatever. And we knew we were capable of beating anyone at home. You ask anyone, Chelsea, Arsenal, Liverpool, Man United, didn't want to come to the Man again. And so, straight away before the ball was put on the spot, psychologically, we had them.
And we were in the spotlight as well because, don't forget, John and I, after the semi-final... That was when we got our opportunity to play international football. Mm. And it was because of the run. It was because we were in the top flight. I think if John and I were playing at a lower level, we'd be, passed over for it.
When you mentioned the semi-final there, and it was Aston Villa, wasn't it, over the two legs? And it was a bit of an epic, wasn't it, Les?
Yeah, well, the first leg, it kept getting postponed, didn't it, because of snow, wasn't it? And then we went there. You got both goals, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah. And I think they had a dubious goal... Was it over the line or not? I'm not because I was on the line about 4 hours over. But then we had the second leg and we were by far the better team against us in the second leg, by far the better team.
I mean, did you think once you got the 2-2 there, was it one of those occasions where you thought, we've got them back at the Manor now?
Yeah, definitely, yeah. But I think what else had happened, Villa had not lost an away tie and we hadn't lost a lone tie, so it sort of one of that lose out on it. And like I say, it was 2-1, but it was a well comfortable 2-1 victory that night.
They scored later on. Wally scored, didn't he, with the chip, I think. Mark Walters for them. I think he scored late on. Put the jitters in for the last 5-10 minutes, whatever it be. But we didn't half play well that night. At Villa Park, I thought we played some great stuff. Yeah. You know, we really did.
That was the main thing, not to come away having lost the game, because it gave us the confidence. But you're talking about Robert Maxwell earlier. I remember before the game coming in, and obviously we were a little bit nervous, a little bit edgy about what's going to happen. And Morris Evans, the manager, came up to me and says, Ray, the chairman wants to have a word with you. He says he's going to talk to you about the 16-yard line. So I started laughing, naturally. You would, you know, I'm thinking, what? Morris, what are you talking about? He's going, I'm being serious with you. He's going to talk to you about the 16-yard line. Just appease him, let him finish his piece. So anyway, we had a tactic board up in the changing room, and all the lads were sitting behind me, and he was kind of coming in, came Houghton over here. So I got to the board with him, right, this is what's going to happen. The opposition will have a corner. They'll put the ball into the box. You stand on the 16-yard line, giggling from behind, the boys all laughing because, you know, we've got schoolboy humour. 16-yard line, we'll head it out. You run the length of the field with the ball, got it? You cross it, Aldridge will score. That's the game gone. And then walked out the door. That was his team talk to me. Anyway, I'm thinking, it's as simple as that. It's all these years we've been worrying about the game, and there's the chairman got it in one single second there. Just get on that 16-yard line. That is what he was like. But in fairness, it relaxed me. I think it relaxed the lads as well. And also at that stage, we had a physio, Ken Fish. And Ken always used to take... There was a little gym that was attached to the home team dressing room. And Fishy always took you in there. You have a Mars bar beforehand. Mars bars would be laid out by your spot. And then he would take you into the gym and give you a warm-up. And you'd have to run around in the gym, and there'd be all these stupid exercises. Down, up, touch your right toe, your left toe, and all things like that. But I think he settled his down, didn't he? Yeah. And even when we got to the final, he did that at Wembley. Yeah. I think the first physio ever in Wembley, we actually cleared everything away
in the changing room.
And we'd done a warm-up in there after we obviously ate our Mars bar first. And then we all got down and done all these exercises. It was hilarious. It was really, really funny, didn't it? And I think all the nerves went out, all the players, both in the semi-final and the final, because in both games we played really well. And that, you know, you have to put some of that contribution down to Ken. And
didn't
just
Ken have a reputation, of getting the wrong knee or the wrong ankle?
Oh, yeah. No, he said, you know, the problem, you know, if you had an ankle injury, he said, you know the problem with that? You've been wearing them Nicky boots, they're too tight for you. Or if you had a groin strain, your jeans were too tight. And there was a time when it was Dean Saunders, when he was rubbing his leg and he was doing it for about 10, 15 minutes, and Dean didn't have the heart to say to him, Mr. Fisher, it's the wrong leg. But quick as a flash, you say, I know that, son. I'm just testing the other one, just to see if they've got a problem there as well. He was a funny old fella, wasn't he? He was great. He was good for us. He'd been at the club, I don't know how many years, John? Donkey's years. And even when we won the cup, this shows you what Morris was like as a man. He allowed him to go up and receive the medal because of the amount of work that he put into the club. And that was testing in Morris. Great gesture from Morris Evans to do that.
Great gesture. Because you're battling for survival. You're at the Milk Cup final, but you're battling for survival in the league, aren't you? And I was just looking at your run in to that Cup final, and you hadn't won in the 7 games coming to the Cup final, including a 6-0 at Liverpool. You know, so what was the mood like?
Well, the game at Liverpool were just untouchable. They're brilliant. To be fair, all the top teams we could handle, but Liverpool, for some reason, whenever we played them when I was at the club, they just battered us 6-0, 4-0, whatever it was.
We were lucky to lose 6-0, weren't we?
They were frightening Liverpool that day. Really. But it was, and I think perhaps what happened with the cup run, we were perhaps looking more at the cup than the league. And, you know, we've seen it happen before, and it's happened since. We took our eye off it a bit, and we knew we all wanted to get Wembley, so much, you know, and getting so close. None of us had ever played at Wembley. And that's what we were talking about. And so we left ourselves a little bit to do at the end of the season, but thankfully we just about did, Jeff. Yeah.
And ironically, it's Queen's Park Rangers in the final, which is Jim Smith's current club, isn't it? And you were very much underdogs, weren't you? Because Rangers were above you in the league, you know. I think they'd beaten you once and you'd drawn once during the league season and such like. And they'd had a fantastic run. They beat Forest and Chelsea and Liverpool on the way there. Did you feel you were underdogs?
Not in the slightest. When they beat Liverpool, like I say, if it was playing Liverpool like we thought we were going to be, it would have been, we got to Wembley, just enjoy it, don't really give us so much chance. But once QPR, everyone thought, I thought we were the favourites personally, like deep down. So I thought we could easily. We did play really well, but I think QPR didn't really perform that day.
Let's go back a little bit. Now, you know, when you go to Wembley today, you know, when you get into cup finals, you get your cup final suit, they're all tailor-made. We had the worst group of suits you've ever seen.
Did you?
It must have been 30 quid a job lot. There was, I've actually got mine in the loft somewhere, which I can assure you doesn't fit me anymore. You'd be surprised to know.
Do you keep it right, did you?
I think it's somewhere about, but I tell you, you could go out and rip it. It was terrible, wasn't it? The standard of
I think QPR, you know, won the suit war. The only thing they won on the day, like, we were like rag-ass Rovers, you know, as Ray said, but they looked the part when they come out, but we looked the part at the end of the day, I think.
Were you on any sort of bonus from Mr. Maxwell then, to win?
Probably, but I can't remember.
I can't remember, no.
They wouldn't have been great. They were maybe about a grand with it for a week.
There was nothing in my shoes when I came in, and no envelope.
Like that.
I was really disappointed about that, Jeff.
But, I mean, it's gone down, hasn't it, Les? It's one of the most one-sided League Cup finals ever. Because I think Alan Judge was in goal. He was. He barely had a shot to save, did he?
A couple of crosses and that, I think, more or less that's what it was. I've never seen Jim Smith so down after a game. He was just devastated, wasn't he, because they hadn't performed. And it's his team that really beat him.
Yeah. But that was the story of the day. That was this whole story. When the build-up to the game, it was Jim Smith versus Jim Smith. Jim Smith's new team against Jim Smith's old team. Apart from myself, I'm trying to think who else, everyone else would have been there this season.
You were the only one, I think.
I think I was the only change from Jim's side from before. So, you know, that was where they were heaping the pressure on Jim, and obviously took a little bit away from Morris, in fairness, because Morris obviously had been the manager all that season. But I think the pressure got to Jim's side, and maybe it was through the fact that it was his old club that he was playing, and I don't know, he's supposed to have known us all inside out because he's worked with the boys for so long, and it just didn't materialise. There was an air of freedom about our play. You know, I think we kept the ball that game as well as we'd done all season. When, you know, there was passing, the midfield wanted it, Les was getting on it, the fullbacks wanted the ball, everyone wanted the ball. And when you looked at the QPR boys, you could see that fear in their face that they were thinking, there was a lot of tension there, a lot of nerves, and they just didn't get into the stride at all in the first 20 minutes, and we were flying at that stage, and Trevor got us off to a great start.
I actually have to say, because Ray was... I thought our midfield that day was magnificent, absolutely brilliant. They couldn't handle it, you know. Defensively, we kept the ball so well. There's no real pressure on Malcolm and Briggsy, the back. They had to deal with long balls, which they did comfortably. But the legs we had in midfield, Trevor Hebbard, you know, he was like he was a proper athlete, Trevor. He could run
Nijinsky,
all day.
Nijinsky, his nickname, wasn't it?
Nijinsky, that's right, you know. But our midfield just ran the show, you know. And I think Ray's goal, you know, summed the day up. The movements and the pass got in. And it was a fantastic goal, fantastic day. And everything about it, I think what Jim Smith meant to do for the club came that day. But, you know, unfortunately... You know, he was the manager that took the hit, which was the sad part of the day for me. But Morris Evans, you know, more than deserved his part in it as well.
So Trevor Hebbard's got the first goal, and the second goal's come just after half-time, and John touched it. What do you remember about it, Ray?
I remember picking the ball up on the left, which I used to do quite a lot. That's what I'm saying, that Morris gave you freedom. You know, he didn't say to you, you got your stick in the one position. I knew if I came infield, Les or someone else would just move across and fill the space that I'd created. So I'd gone over to the left and Trevor was up. We played a little 1-2 a couple of times down the left-hand side and we just went past him with ease. You know, it was not as if there was anyone that came and closed us down. It was I passed it to him, he passed it back to me, I passed it to him. And he got great acceleration, Trevor. You know, he was a fantastic athlete, up and down the pitch, wanted the ball. He had a special game that day as well. He was tremendous, you know, obviously scoring the goal and helping me get the second. I remember a ball coming across the face of the goal and I thought, you know, all you've got to do is get it on target. And I slid in and, you know, went past Paul Barron, I think it was in goal, to get the second goal. And my only thought then afterwards was to run over to where my family and friends are, you know, to go and celebrate with them. Because, as John says, as players, I was 26, I think, 24 at the time. I'd waited a long time to get my opportunity. You know, Les had waited a long time. John had waited a long time to get to the top flight of football. And to play at Wembley was a dream come true for all of us.
Can you see them, Ray? When, you know, you've got 90,000 people there. Can you see them?
What you do, though, Jeff, is before the game, you find out where the seats are. Mm. So you give them a little wave before the match, and then as you come out, you know, that lining up for the national anthem and all that, you know, you are, aren't you? Your heart's going up 10 to the dozen, and you panic, and your first thought goes through your head is, don't make a fool of yourself today. You know, please do something decent. The cameras are watching, your family and friends are here. Just make sure you go out and enjoy the day.
And after your goal was game over.
I thought it was game over before that.
Yeah.
I thought the first 5 minutes of the second half, you're thinking they've got to come out. They've got to do something different today. They haven't really shown us anything of the play that QPR had done for the majority of the season, which was a disappointing to them. But we were extremely happy with it. We just thought, right, let's keep getting at them, and if we can get the second goal, it'll be game over.
And of course, Robert Maxwell celebrated very publicly on the field, didn't he?
Oh, he was unbelievable. He was unbelievable. You'd think he'd won the trophy himself. You know, he was unbelievable, John, wasn't he? He didn't have a lot to say. His knowledge of the game wasn't particularly good, but he loved the limelight. If there was a camera, yeah. You know, it was action, ready, hair's done, ready to go.
That was exactly the reason why he bought the club, for that moment, for that day. You know, and whatever he paid for it was all worthwhile for what he got out of it. You know, his marketing for himself was excellent. Yeah. You know, everyone was winning.
I'm sure you didn't think about it at the time, but later, Les, was it just an element of disappointment, you know, that it didn't get you into Europe because, you know,
something that was totally out of our hands. You just had to take it on the chin. It was just, you know, nothing you can do about it. But it was, obviously, these boys have played internationally and that, but for me, not to, you know, just have a go at the best in, like, in Europe, it was a big, like, loss, I must admit. Quite was.
Season wasn't over, though, was it?
No.
Because, you know, in the league, it went to the very last day. You had to be Arsenal on the last day, wasn't
it? We did, yeah. I remember we had two home games left, if I'm right. We knew we had to win at least one of them. We had Forest at home, then Arsenal at home, and we always thought, Forest, the one we've got to win. You know, the chances are we won't beat Arsenal. And then Forest gave us a good scene. They come to our place and they were superb. Young Cluffy played well. I think they won us 2-0.
2-1, I think.
2-1, 2-0, whatever it was. And then it was left, you know, to the last game of the season, Arsenal at home. And, you know, again, it was like a cup final. You know, the old...
But there was a game prior to that, John.
Was it?
Everton. We beat Everton at home. 1-0. Didn't Les get the goal in that game? Do you remember that?
Right.
Everton got, because Everton were going for the double that year as well. You know, and you were talking about Liverpool.
We beat Everton 1-0.
Yeah, and we beat Everton 1-0. Les scored the goal. And that was where Everton were. They needed to win that because Liverpool started to close the gap on them. And for us, a Liverpool fan, for us to win that game and help Liverpool along the way, I remember probably he got more enjoyment out of that game against Everton than any other one that season because, you know, he was, from John's eyes, he was helping Liverpool maybe, get that balance
true,
right and get ahead of Everton. And it was a game that really was great for us because obviously it kept the momentum going. But from Everton's point of view, I think that was the one game that changed it in Liverpool's favour to win the league that season.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I'm probably getting mixed up because there's so many home games towards the end of the season. But it was left to the Arsenal game. I was delighted with the Everton game because Les had scored the win. I took him out, bought him free ale all night, which was something that I was a bit averse to do at the time. And we had a super night. Liverpool went on to win the league. And then obviously we had Arsenal last game of the season. And that was really nervous, wasn't it? It was like
it's almost like another cup final. It was, two cup finals in a matter of weeks.
Well,
really.
Morris took a big gamble in the game, didn't he? Because Billy Hamilton hadn't been fit for long spells. And obviously Charlo had played in the cup final, but he knew he needed a big presence up there that day. And John and Billy, prior to him getting injured, had a great understanding, didn't you? Absolutely. Yeah. Billy was like a big battering ram. He took all the knocks for him, and he would flick the balls down, and John would be in there. And you knew he's worth
to you, John. He was great to play alongside. Charlo was a very, very good player. But for me, me and Billy just went together so well. You know, like, you know, you got Tosha Keegan's, that sort of... We just had...
It just
developed from day one when we knew each other, and when he got injured, I was so disappointed. We don't mind with Charlo, but as Ray said, it was quite canny from Morris. You know, Billy probably had one game in him.
Yeah.
You know, and that he decided that was the 90 minutes to throw him on against Arsenal, and they couldn't deal with him. He was brilliant. He was man of the match for me. He was brilliant that day, wasn't he?
Yeah. So you got your goal as well?
Yeah, I got a goal. I can't remember the scorers that day. I remember, obviously.
I'll tell you them.
Go on.
You got one, and Ray got one. I can't think of who got the other one, but you know, it's 3-0.
I think Billy Hamilton got the other one, didn't he? I think Billy got a goal. I can't remember. I think Billy, certainly, as John said, we needed someone that day who was going to be a major influence up front, who was going to hold on to the ball and fight. And you could see the two Arsenal centre-halves that day thinking, oh, my God, we don't need this. We really don't need. I don't think they could have went up and down on the league, you know. So it might have been a nothing game for them. But I tell you what, the atmosphere was as good as it had been all season. And the fans came in the thousands to back us. And I think once we got to the ground, we all knew, didn't we? There was like a feeling around the place. It's going to be our day. We're going to be all right today. And I tell you, we went about Arsenal in the right manner from the first whistle, didn't we? We were right after them. We got in their faces. I mean, they had all the stars, all the players that you would imagine should get on the ball and that. But it was going to be our day. There was nothing that was going to stop us. And it started with Big Billy up front. I think he gave us an extra boost knowing that he was in the team, because you knew, nothing against Charlo. Charlo's one of my good friends, you know what I mean? So there's nothing against Charlo at the time. It was just Billy was an inspiration. You know, he'd said, you know what, lads, I've got a bad knee, but I'm going to go out there and battle for you. I'm going to give you everything I've got for as long as I can. And I think that was just typical of how we'd been all season. You know, this group that, you know, you'd go that extra mile for each other. And for Billy to go and do what he did was just tremendous. And I think we fed off that, didn't we? That enthusiasm he had to go out there and really get something out of the game. And then once again, I thought we played really well that day.
So yeah, we did,
good football, but, you know, there was a determination, a desire to win.
Let's just talk about what happened afterwards for all three of you. I mean, obviously, you know, John, Ray, you've both ended up at Liverpool, you know, which is obviously a dream come true for you. Mm-hmm. But Oxford was really the launch pad for your career, wasn't it? I know you did brilliantly at Newport County, but this was the
Very much so, Jeff. Yeah, very much so. You know, we've got a lot to be thankful for. And
was Robert Maxwell involved in that?
he was in the end. It was a strange one, Jeff. Obviously, I was told prior to the Manchester City game, we played Man City away, by Morris Evans, that they'd accepted a bid from Liverpool before a game, he told me, which was ridiculous because I went out and I played crap. And then after I met Robert Maxwell on the Sunday, he spoke to me about Liverpool coming in up, obviously with the bid, $750,000, he's accepted it, but I've got to stay at the club and see them through the FA Cup. Which I thought, what? So I've got to stay at Oxford United whilst we're in the FA Cup, which was like giving someone a present and taking it back off them. And then he gets on the phone to the pool chairman, and he says to me, John, who's the highest paid player at Liverpool? I went, I'm not sure, probably Mr. Dalglish or Ian Rush. And he went, Smith. He saw the Liverpool chairman. I want John Aldridge to be on the same wages as either Mr. Rush or Mr. Dalglish. And then he wants me to play in the FA Cup. I thought, this deal's not going to go through. But unfortunately for Oxford, fortunately for me, we got beaten in the third round of the FA Cup at Aldershot. And I went to Liverpool the following week.
And of course, Ray, you went to Liverpool as well.
Tell the other story, though. Oh. Tell the other bit of the story about... He said to you, I'm going to give you a dream move.
Yeah, of course. I forgot. He did say, we're typifying the way Robert Maxwell was with football. And he said, now, John, the Liverpool deal is going through. Now that you're going to play for Liverpool, you'll be able to play for England. I looked at him and I thought, is he taking the piss? And I said, I play for the Republic of Ireland, Mr. Maxwell. He said, it doesn't matter when you play for Liverpool, you play for England. And, you know, Morris Evans didn't know what to laugh or cry. And I didn't know what to do. I just went, yeah, all right.
Yeah. Of course, you got Liverpool as well, Ray. You plenty of options, though, didn't you? I think Celtic were in for you, and Arsenal, and Inter Milan were even in.
I remember going to see Morris Evans, and I said to Morris, you know, there's been a lot of speculation. I said, what do you think I need to do to improve my game? You know, what can I do to get to this next level? And he said, well, he said, you're crap at tackling, Ray. You're useless. So I said, I'll go out and improve it. And he just looked at me and went, no, you won't. I said, what do you mean? He said, you'll always see danger going into your tackle. Les Phillips won't see danger. All he'll see is the ball. So he'll just go in there. You'll never have that. So I was like, are you sure? And he went, yeah.
So I said, right, so what else have I got to do then to improve my game? So I knew then, you know, there was only, you know, I was never been a tackle. I was always someone to just get in the way of people and try to stop them from that point of view. Yeah, I had options. I spoke to George Graham at Arsenal. The only thing when I spoke to George, he was talking more about Liverpool than Arsenal. I thought, are you trying to get me Arsenal or Liverpool? You know, it was a really strange discussion with him. He says he wanted to change the ethos at Arsenal. He wanted to go more like Liverpool, passing and moving, and that's the calibre of player he's trying to bring in. But once I knew Kenny was interested, then that was the club that was going to be for me. But I've got one regret out of that, and that was the late, great Brian Clough wanted me to go and speak to him at Nottingham Forest. And there was a chief scout rang me up to go and speak to him. I said, look, no, I'm not going to. I said, I'm going to go to Liverpool. And Brian Clough gave me a bit of stick in the newspapers, and rightly so. And I think he went along and he said, well, it would have been worth it just to come and speak to me alone. And that's very true. And I regret that. I wish I went and spoke to him at that particular time, just to hear what he had to say.
Fantastic memories, but how do you feel now, you know, John, when you look at the league tables and you see that just over 20 years later, they're a conference side?
Really saddened, you know. You can ask anyone, the teams that you played for, you've always got, you know, deep emotions for them. And Oxford's right in that category for me, you know. Great feelings for what they actually done for us. And to see them slide and the way they did was, you know, it's heartbreaking, really. And the only thing is they've got a real nice ground there. They've got, you know, some solidity, you know, at the club. And the end of last season, they've done really well. There's a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel for them. Not saying they're going to get back to the dizzy heights where they were with us, but, you know, hopefully they can get back into the Football League where they really do belong. You know, it's the second division or the Coca-Cola, you know, the higher the better. Mm.
The good thing is they've got a really good chairman. He's a football man, you know. He knows football, totally opposite.
Unlike the chairman that you had.
And he's willing to put money in. So I'll go and watch him nearly every home game anyway. And towards the end of the season, they were just winning but playing really well. And I've really got high hopes from next season. They look like a very good manager as well.
Mm. Well, whatever happens in the future to Oxford, they can never take away that historic day, can they, when you lifted the Milk Cup. So, Ray, Les, John, thanks very much for sharing those memories.
More sport, news and views at skysports.com.